Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be here today. I'm only sorry that I couldn't have come a bit early this morning, as was the original schedule, but some of you may know that we had a minor discussion last night in London with a full and frank discussion with a few people who were actually invited into the House of Commons. I'm all for open government, but there is a limit on these things. But nevertheless, I'm very pleased to be here today and to also be in this impressive and fascinating setting for the start of the global canopy season here at the Eden Project. And of course, one of the great strengths of the Eden Project is that it is a global leader and a global facility. And it does have a global role to play. And in that respect, it's a very appropriate venue for hosting this particular conference. It's also worth saying that today is World Ozone Day. And the ozone layer protects all forms of life from harmful ultraviolet light from the sun. So just as the Eden Project is protecting plant life, the ozone layer is also protecting us all. And of course, you all know about the fact that 30 years ago, compelling scientific evidence, actually led by British scientists, demonstrated that the ozone in the upper atmosphere was increasingly under threat from ozone-depleting chemicals that arise from economic activity. Governments responded to that threat, and the 1987 Montreal Protocol provided the basis for comprehensive action to limit the use of ozone-depleting substances, and a great deal of action has been taken on that, both in this country and in others. And we can point to the Montreal Protocol as an excellent example in the way that governments can act to confront a major global environmental threat. It does give me encouragement that people can work together internationally in terms of dealing with the threats that we face. And the latest scientific evidence shows that the growth in the size of the ozone hole is now slowing, although it is still growing. And it's only with continued compliance of the terms of the protocol that we can hope for the ozone hole to disappear. And there will be further action taken in terms of replacing damaging gases in appliances, and that will continue. Now, in terms of this conference, these 2 days are an exciting opportunity for some of the best minds in the global canopy community to come together and to exchange information and ideas and to bring the exciting subject of canopy science to a broader audience. I was impressed to hear that the Eden Project has the tallest canopy in captivity. It sounds like it's under house arrest, but it's quite impressive. And it certainly helps bring home to a wider audience the importance of conserving what are precious resources in a vivid and striking way. And it's a very impressive range of speakers and subjects you have in these 2 days. And I really wish I could spend a bit more time listening to some of the presentations, because they look so interesting. But the canopy season is being launched today, and it's the first of its kind. And I'm sure it will highlight the importance of the forest canopy, raise awareness of the threats to this habitat, and raise awareness of the important science that's used to study it. The forest canopy is the primary interface between the earth and the atmosphere, and plays a key role in regulating the climate and its change. Forests provide other essential services such as pollution mitigation, carbon sequestration, and oxygen creation, as well as playing an important role in soil stabilization, therefore helping to prevent natural disasters. Forests can also help with the regulation of water supply, and we've seen some of the consequences of large-scale deforestation around the world and the problems that's brought. Forests are also home to 350 million people, which is sometimes forgotten. That's more than the total population of the USA. And those forests make a significant contribution to human livelihoods through the provision of food, materials, and natural medicines. Yet this habitat is under serious threat from climate change, from urban development and deforestation. Impacts on canopy species or processes could have large cascading effects on the rest of the forest and the ecosystems that it provides. The forest canopy is also one of the richest habitats on Earth, supporting possibly up to 40% of the world's terrestrial species. It's vital to the planet's biodiversity, but is one of the most threatened, yet one of the most underexplored habitats on Earth. It remains so because of the practical difficulties of exploring its high frontier. I was quite interested that one of the talks is some of the technology in terms of dealing with that. And it's very important that we are able to improve our understanding of canopy habitats and the species and processes within them in order to determine the nature and likely consequences of threats, and ultimately to help us find ways to mitigate them. And that's why the science that you will be discussing today is so important, is so vital, because it does give us the information that we need in terms of dealing with this. Now, I have, as Environment Minister, been privileged to witness a range of work internationally, and on a visit earlier this year to the Danone Valley Research Centre in Sabah, I was delighted to announce that my department, the Department of Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, will be supporting some important work for canopy science through the Darwin Initiative, which we administer through DEFRA. The Tropical Forest Training Programme for the ASEAN region is to be carried out by the University of Oxford in conjunction with the Global Canopy Programme. It's aiming to build capacity for investigating forest canopy biodiversity. The sheer height of the canopies requires specialised training in access methods. And UK expertise will help Malaysia establish a canopy field course for the region. It will help build capacity for training, and it will produce a training manual. The project will also help reach agreement between Malaysia and the ASEAN on a forest canopy training strategy. And it is a wonderful area in Danone Valley. It has involvement from the Kew Gardens, has involvement in relation to DEFRA in terms of the support that we've given for many years through the Darwin Project. I did rather foolhardily climb a canopy ladder at Danone Valley. It didn't look quite as high from the bottom as I realised halfway up that it actually was. I also discovered that the ladder had been, it's a fixed ladder, had been there on the tree trunk for some years, actually. It's part of long-term studies in Danone Valley. And the trunk had actually grown out very close to the rungs on the ladder, as I also discovered halfway up when I couldn't get my toes on the ladder. My private secretary was fainting at the bottom ladder at the career damaging prospect of having a minister fall from a very large height. And also I would have fallen the Malaysian minister on the way down as well, so that would have been even more embarrassing, basically. I managed to get down okay, although what I did discover that I was warned that Danone Valley was the capital of leeches, and they gave me these very famous leech socks, which those of you who work in rainforest will be very familiar with, and I was very reassured that these things would not get up my socks and up my trousers. What they didn't tell me is that they drop down the back of your neck when you go up trees, which is exactly what they did. So that was an experience as well. But it was wonderful to see and experience that biodiversity and that area. And it is important that we do recognise that these important and fragile habitats are under threat. And one of the biggest threats is, of course, climate change. It has serious impacts worldwide, but there are other problems just as disturbing. We're currently losing biodiversity at an unprecedented rate, and this destruction is man-made. This is not just about losing beautiful, interesting species, but about the loss of ecological stability and essential services, ecological services, which underpin our quality of life and the genetic and biological diversity that we are losing daily. Now, some of the loss of diversity, apart from it's a tragedy in itself in relation to our responsibilities globally, we could also be losing biodiversity that could yield new medicines, crops, and other useful products. My department is committed to international efforts to halt the current decline and to meet the target that was agreed at the World Summit on Sustainable Development to achieve a significant reduction in the rate of biodiversity loss by 2010. But we recognise that is a huge challenge, and it does require international cooperation. And we have a role to play in that, not only in terms of our direct work in relation to the quality of our science, which of course is world class, but also in terms of working with other countries and the expertise and knowledge that we have, and on occasions giving them support, both financial and practical. Those of you here today and the rest of the biodiversity community don't need convincing on the importance of stemming biodiversity loss, nor do you need convincing of the connections between biodiversity and sustainable livelihoods and the human impacts of biodiversity loss. But if we are to change the practices that result in biodiversity loss, we have to get across much more widely the importance to human society of biodiversity and the ecosystem services that it supports. And we need to get the message across that sustainable development must go hand in hand in relation to biodiversity protection. And that, of course, what happens as well in other countries does have an impact on our own and others. So it is that partnership approach. And we must get that message over, firstly to political leaders across the world, through forums like the United Nations, through the World Sustainable the World Summit on Sustainable Development. We have to get it across to the owners and managers of businesses, and of course, most importantly, we have to get that message across to the wider public. We have to demonstrate that ecosystem management is of benefit, of course, to people who live in those areas and who rely upon them. The Eden Project's mission is making an absolutely vital contribution to this, as is your own work in this field. The series of events launched today will play an important part in getting that crucial message across to people, and I warmly congratulate the Eden Project and the Big Canopy Programme for their vision and ambition. I wish you all a successful meeting over the next 2 days, and I look forward to hearing about the results and following on from some of the discussions, because I'm quite sure that there will be points which will be raised here, discussed here, that I think may be very valuable in terms of feeding into the international process that we are a key part in relation to the UK in the partnership role that we play globally as well. So thank you for your contributions. Thank you for inviting me here today to say a few words and also to look around this magnificent facility here, and good luck for the future with all the work that you've been doing in such a vital, precious and important ecosystem that we must face up to our responsibilities in terms of protecting for the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ian. Actually, it's a funny thing. When I was younger, discovering canopy roots, I was known as the princess of canopy biology. I've been lately known as the queen of canopy of biology, and I dread the day when I am known as the mother of canopy biology. I think that day is coming. But in the meantime, I would like to talk about an aspect of diversity. This whole session has been about biodiversity of the forest canopy, and when we think about diversity, we tend to think first about taxonomic diversity, which we have been told about very ably by Joaquin Adiz and Dr. Mori and Roger Kitching about the number of species that occur in tropical rainforest canopies. And there is this human fascination with diversity, the number of different species that live in canopies. And so a lot of canopy work has been preoccupied with enumerating and identifying and understanding the reasons for this diversity and simply counting up the number of species. So a lot of diversity has been, or a lot of canopy studies have been involved with simply this idea of how many species are there. And a lot of that has been taken up with taxonomic diversity, that is, producing keys so that we can identify, for example, this canopy ant. We put that in a classification system of the phylum Arthropoda, the class Insecta, and so forth, down Hymenoptera, Formicidae, Cypermyrmex, and then the species name. Well, this fascination of diversity can extend to human type interactions as well. For instance, this is a British breakfast. It's a meal, it's a breakfast, it's an English breakfast, it's a full English breakfast, and it is it contains kippers. In America, we tend to look at diversity of breakfast in terms of our breakfast cereals, and if you look at actually our, look at diversity in human societies, in human arenas like the aisles of cereals of a supermarket, you can see that we could also classify cereals and breakfasts in terms of either what they're made of, that is cocoa, or the color of the, what the front piece of the cereal looks like. But I would like to talk about different kinds of diversity today, different kinds of canopy diversity. First of all, very briefly, talking about the diversity of access mechanisms and measurements that canopy researchers make. Secondly, the diversity of adaptations of animals and plants to the arboreal environment. And finally, the diversity of forest canopy structure, the way that we look at the different elements of forest canopies, as well as the way that we present data with respect to forest structure. So in terms of the first kind of diversity, access mechanisms, we'll be hearing a lot about later on during the conference during the next 2 days. We have diverged and diversified from simply climbing trees with canopy access, modified mountain climbing techniques, to include a variety of ways that we can get up into the canopy in order to make measurements, observations, and do experiments of forest canopy biota. Some of these canopy access mechanisms have allowed us to actually observe and quantify and document and communicate the amazing kinds of interactions and developments that canopy animals and plants have made to adapt themselves to the arboreal environment. For instance, simply hanging on. How do we hang on in the canopy? This is of concern to anything that lives in the canopy. We can think about the development of prehensile tails, of grasping hands, whether they are monkeys, apes, or humans, in terms of hanging on, defying gravity, and being able to grasp canopy structures in order to make one's way around the arboreal environment. Something that's a bit more subtle involves the physiological interactions and adaptations. For instance, the canopy snakes. When you think about a canopy snake that has to move vertically within the canopy, such as this corn snake in temperate forests, you have to think about how do their circulation systems work? What adaptations have allowed them to climb up into the canopy without their blood pooling the way that we might expect terrestrial snakes? And in fact, this has received a lot of attention by a group from the University of Florida. They actually equate their work to the work that's been done on giraffe physiology, which is a bit of a stretch, but really presents the same problem of having a heart well below the brain, and how does blood get up there and stay up there? And so the work by Charles Lillywhite and his colleagues, for example, at University of Florida, have looked at and compared the blood vasculature of arboreal and terrestrial snakes versus sea snakes, which don't have that same problem because of the hydrostatic forces of water in aquatic environments. And these are some rather gruesome looking experiments where snakes are put in tubes, they're tipped up and down, and there's been an examination of where, for example, the heart and the vascular system is. And you can see here, going from your left to right, arboreal snakes have a higher, their hearts are actually raised relative to the vascular system of terrestrial and marine snakes, which I think is just unbelievably cool, and really gives you an idea that there is sort of a physiological adaptation to the arboreal habitat in many ways. Many botanists have worked on the physiology of plant adaptations to the canopy environment. In dry habitats such as South Florida and Texas, epiphytes, the plants that grow in trees, have a number of physiological adaptations that allow them to take advantage of atmospheric moisture. And so we can see in this bromeliad, a tillandsia, that there are special organs on the plant, special trichomes or hairs that are very adept at absorbing atmospheric moisture, even though it may not be in the form of rain or mist, taking that into account and taking that into their systems and being able to essentially live off of very low amounts of moisture in the canopy. In cloud forest ecosystems, where I do a lot of my own research in Monteverde, plants also have the ability to sieve or take out moisture and nutrients from the mist and fog that come in on a regular basis. This is true also in temperate montane forests, where you get a sieving effect of canopy plants due to the fineness of their foliage. Other adaptations include the different structures of hummingbird bills that we see in canopy birds that pollinate, gain nectar, and do pollination work within the canopy. And there's a tremendous diversity of the shapes of bills of different hummingbirds for the different plants that occur in the forest canopy. So we see that there are a number of adaptations of plants and animals to the arboreal environment. as I began looking at some of these adaptations, I noted that many of them have to do, many of these adaptations have to do with the structural diversity of the canopy and the arboreal environment. That is, if you climb up into this tree, you'll see an enormous range of microhabitats that can be used, that can be occupied by different plants and animals, ranging from little skinny, tiny, teeny twigs to very large, massive trunks and large branches. And so a single tree then represents a tremendous variety of structural, really a structural smorgasbord that different plants and animals can take advantage of. And when you start looking at the literature of forest structure, you can see that there are a number of scientific fields that basically rely on forest structure or rely on forest structure to explain what people are interested in. So people interested in ecosystem processes, in biodiversity, in wildlife biology, aesthetics, physiology, resource management, and landscape ecology all are interested in some aspect of forest structure. In fact, when you start looking at the scientific literature itself, you do a search on forest structure, what we found was that there are nearly 90,000 citations on forest ecology, and of those, about 9,000 of them concern some aspect of forest structure. So over 10% of all of the forest ecological literature has something to do with forest structure. And indeed, when you're in the canopy, you can start witnessing the importance of different structural elements. For example, if you're climbing in the canopy of a temperate coniferous forest, where you see Douglas fir twigs, you can see that lichens, such as this Alectoria, this goat's beard lichen, basically catches itself. It sort of gets caught by these live twigs, as well as by the dead twigs. And it's really like sort of the spaghetti on the tines of a fork. And it's those tiny little structures that allow the colonization of these particular kinds of lichens on the branch ends of live and dead twigs. Alternatively, when you move back along those same twigs and you get slightly larger diameter twigs, you'll see some very different kinds of lichens that specialize on that particular substrate. So you see these kinds of parmelia lichens that are growing on this particular diameter. And when you get into a situation where there are large diameter branches, you get these wonderful mosses that colonize, but not the Alectoria or the Parmelia. So that you can see that there are different types of microhabitats that allow the colonization of different kinds of lichens and mosses, which then promotes a greater species diversity. Certain kinds of animals also specialize on different kinds of canopy elements. For instance, this is the northern spotted owl in the Pacific Northwest that tends to specialize and forage in the moss mats that grow upon large canopy diameter, large branch diameter branches in the Pacific Northwest. The marbled murrelet, which is a threatened species, is only known to make nests, again, on these moss mats and lay eggs on these moss mats of large old growth forest interior trees. You don't see this bird nesting anywhere else except this particular kind of structural element. Similarly, in tropical forests, we see that certain birds use particular canopy structural elements, using mosses for the construction of nest sites by hummingbirds, the prong-billed barbet and the ochraceous wren, which is down below there, forages exclusively in these mats of mosses and dead organic matter for invertebrates that live up there. So there's a degree of specialization, I think, that's very important in terms of understanding the structural diversity and its effect on diversity in general. So what we've seen then is that there are these adaptations to structure which increase the amount of diversity that live in the forest canopies. And what I'd like to talk about next is the measurement and the presentation of forest structural measurement of forest structure. In the early days of forest ecology, basically people were restricted to the forest floor, and they were restricted also in terms of the kinds of measurements that they could make. So basically we would measure things like the diameter at breast height, or the height of trees measured with clinometers. We were basically restricted to measurements of forest structure on the forest floor. So profile diagrams, for example, were made by cutting chunks of forest and making measurements remotely from the forest floor to try to describe and quantify the structure of a particular piece of forest. But as we have been able to get up into the forest canopy, there has been a growing diversity of ways that we can both measure and describe forest structure. So we can use canopy cranes to get up into the coniferous forest and to the tropical rainforest to take images and to make measurements of forest structure. The advent of computer graphics has also been a tremendous help in terms of visualizing canopy structure. This is some work by Akihiro Sumida, a Japanese ecologist, forest biologist, who has been able to make stick figures of tree architecture of chestnut trees in Japan. Some of the measurements that have been made have been fairly simple in terms of taking real measurements and then translating them into what we can see here as an age sequence of Douglas fir trees. We can look at the foliage distribution, another structural measurement along an age sequence as well. So this is simply a graphic which is looking at how the distribution of foliage occurs on different species within a forest. And another, again, computer graphic image of the distribution of foliage in an eastern deciduous forest by Jess Parker to try to give you a three-dimensional image of what the distribution of foliage is in this forest. I think one of the really exciting new developments in terms of canopy research, especially forest canopy research, has been to try to understand not only the canopy solids, that is, the foliage, the branches, the trunks, but also to understand that the forest canopy is composed of airspace. And so some recent work by Roman Dial has been trying to look at what is the airspace, what are the interstices of the forest, and what implication might those have if we could measure that, as we can now with new techniques, computer graphic techniques and field techniques. How does that have an implication, for example, in terms of the evolution of gliding mammals? And so Roman Dial is now going from tropical forest to temperate forest, measuring airspace in order to understand why gliding mammals are really prevalent in old world forests, Asian forests, but not in new world forests like Latin American forests. So I think that's a very exciting new wrinkle in terms of understanding forest structure worldwide. Well, in terms of trying to understand structure, in terms of our reviewing the literature, trying to understand forest structure, I hearken back to the old story of the seven blind men and the elephant, in which each blind man went to an elephant and grabbed one piece of it and said, well, I understand this element to be a rope because that particular blind person grabbed the trunk or the sword or the fan of the ear or the column of the leg. And in fact, that's really where I think we sort of are in terms of understanding forest structure. We're all grabbing different pieces of the elephant. And that's kind of all right if you're satisfied with looking at pieces of forest structure. But what we're all trying to do now in canopy studies, I think, is to come to some sort of integration. So rather than going to a single forest like this Monteverde cloud forest and saying, well, I'm just looking at leaf surface, or I'm seeing nests, or I'm measuring stem volume, et cetera, et cetera. What we want to do is to try to find some integrated way of looking at forest structure so that we can start comparing a cloud forest to a temperate forest, or a boreal forest in the north with an English forest here in the deciduous zone. And so some of my colleagues and I are now trying to understand how we can go about classifying this very complex thing, which is forest structure. In order to do that, we began looking at other fields of science, other fields of human endeavor that have tried to do exactly that, try to understand how to classify something that's complicated. We started with something as simple as luggage. If any of you have come here from a long way, you worry about losing your luggage. What happens when I lose my luggage? How will I describe that piece of luggage? Well, it turns out that the airlines have figured out a very simple taxonomy of luggage. And you can now go, when you lose your luggage, you can go to the luggage counter and say, well, does it have a zipper or not? Is it hard or is it soft? Is it blue or is it black? There's a very simple way of sort of empirically, that is experimentally, understanding where your piece of luggage fits. And sure enough, you can find, oh, number 8A, that's my piece of luggage, and that's how it's classified. There are other ways of classifying complicated things. When we think about gems, for example, something important to humans because they represent things like wedding rings. It turns out that in the field of gemology, Gems are classified in a very, very quantified, simple way. That is, there are sort of six ways to cut a diamond. You can identify those different ways. When you go to a jeweler, you can say, well, this is the cut I want, this is the color I want, this is the clarity, and the carat. And so you can actually classify every possible gem by this four-way technique of classification. If any of you are soil scientists here, you're familiar with the Munsell color spates, in which you can identify any color of any soil by three basic ways: the hue, the chroma, and the value. And there are these wonderful things called Munsell color soil charts, in which you can hold up your soil and you can find what color it is, and you can communicate that color in a quantitative way to other soil scientists. So we began, my colleagues and I have begun to try to think about forest canopy representations in a number of quantified ways. We can say, well, there are three general categories in which people can look at forest canopy structure. First, as an array of components. Second, as a collection of networks. And third, as a continuous medium. So an example of an array of components would be, say, the distribution of leaves. That's just a simple array of components. Or downed logs on the forest floor. That would be another array of components. Secondly, we might think about those that would fit into the collection of networks. And here we have, for example, networks that are connected to each other. Branches are connected to particular trees. And so Dr. Sumita's chestnut trees would fit into this category. And thirdly, we might think of a general category as being a continuous medium. And this is a contour map of the top of the canopy of a particular forest that was taken from using a canopy crane, simply dropping down, getting the contour measurements of that surface. After we've split up your canopy measurements into one of these three types of representations, we can think about their dimensionality, that any of these could be represented as a one, two, or three-dimensional figure. So here are the down logs as a one-dimensional figure, a two-dimensional figure, or a three-dimensional figure, if you can take three-dimensional measurements of that. Similarly, with a continuous medium, we can say, well, here's a two-dimensional continuous medium, and here's a three-dimensional continuous medium, if we have the data to portray them that way. We can also think about whether the surfaces are reactive or non-reactive. So in the case of leaves, they might be reactive with respect to sunlight. We can classify them that way. Or if we were looking at the distribution of bird nests within a canopy, they would be not reactive with respect to sunlight. And finally, we can talk about whether or not these different representations are spatially referenced or spatially independent, and those would contribute to our overall classification of all the different kinds of structural categories in which we could put our forest structures. So what we're trying to do now is to take every single forest structure study and to place it, to give it an address within this overall conceptual framework of forest canopy structure. And in that way, just like a single soil color can fit within a Munsell soil color chart, we can do the same thing with our forest structure measurements. It's a first step in terms of really trying to create an overall universal conceptual model of how forests are put together. And it was generated by the need to do that for forest canopy, understanding forest canopy studies. So just some examples in terms of these different addresses. Here's a three-dimensional array of components that are not reactive and not spatially referenced. Here we have a two-dimensional array of components, not reactive, absolutely spatially referenced, and a two-dimensional continuous medium, non-reactive, absolutely spatially referenced. And finally, our exciting airspace, a two-dimensional continuous medium that's non-reactive and absolutely spatially referenced. So we hope together, you know, to sort of put together the whole elephant, so to speak, in terms of understanding forest canopy structure. The final thing that I'd like to do is to just emphasize that although many forest canopy researchers focus on data that can be portrayed and fit into the components I just described, there are other ways. There is a diversity of ways in which we can also provide forest canopy information. And I want to just give you an example of this with an exercise I started last year called data sonification, which is to present data in the form of sound. Because very often when you sit, actually it generated because, you know, you sit in scientific meetings and you see graph after graph after graph. And I always wondered, well, what would those data sound like? And so I worked together with a computer scientist and a database person, and we put together some information, some Canopy data, and we set it to music. So that the data, which are in effect numbers, and music, which is also really numbers, can be made into sound. So the little piece of data that I'd like to present to you actually come from the Monteverde Cloud Forest Reserve, where I've done a lot of canopy research. It's just a heaven for epiphytes. It's a fantastic place to do research on canopies. What we did was we removed mats of epiphytes and the dead organic matter that accumulates under there. We were very interested in the seed bank, that is the seeds that lodge themselves in both terrestrial and arboreal plants actually have seeds that, live and are waiting there to sprout out. We dug little soil pits, we extracted the seeds, we identified the seeds, and we came up we also grew them up so that we would know what seeds were, which were which. And we came up with a number of data slides that now I'd like to present to you just as a sort of an example of the different ways that you can present data. And so you can look at the data and hear the data at the same time, if I can get this to go. These are arboreal shrubs, the seeds of arboreal shrubs in the canopy. And so you'll hear two different tones. These are all the species in the canopy mats. I think that is so cool. I just think it's so wonderful. But here's the sort of, what follows is a little bit sad. That is, one of the things that we're working on are the effects of global climate change on canopy plants. As many of you know, in tropical cloud forests, the effects of global climate change are predicted to be fairly dire. That is, the mist that bathes the tops of tropical cloud forests is essentially moving upward. As you get a warming of land and sea surface temperatures, you get a lifting air effect. And many of the animals, for example, the golden toad, which lives in Monteverde, or lived in Monteverde, which is now extinct due to warmer climates, as well as the canopy epiphytes, are subject to desiccation and death. And so what our last series of experiments in Costa Rica has involved looking at what this lifting cloud effect has on canopy epiphytes. We've done a number of transplant experiments where we've taken mats of epiphytes, moved them slightly lower on the mountains, exposed them to lower to drier, warmer conditions, and marked leaves to be able to monitor how many leaves are growing. And what we found was that there was a significant drying effect and death effect. This is a mat, for example, up in the upper cloud forest that was undisturbed. It's doing fine. The mats that we brought down lower in the community exposed them to drier conditions. Basically, most of them died off, with a few exceptions, when they were exposed to the same kinds of environmental conditions that we predict for global environmental change with a doubling of CO2. So this was a fairly sobering result. It was not unexpected, but basically there are just a few species in the Monteverde canopy, in the cloud forest canopy, that will be able to survive climate effects as predicted. And just to give you again a sort of an audio sense of that, I'm going to replay all of the species that will live there, and the next slide will be the data of just the species that are going to that did survive under global climate change effects. And these are the surviving species, the ones that were capable of living under those effects. in effect, it's a much diminished, much less diverse habitat than what might be experienced under global climate change effects. So I think some of the challenges that remain for people looking at forest canopy structure is what we talked about earlier, which is to try to bring together a conceptual framework for comparing, doing comparative work in different kinds of forest ecosystems. A second challenge is to try to take into account the kinds of forest structures and canopy structures that occur in human-affected habitats. Nearly all of the research that has been done to date in forest canopies has been in primary and pristine, or whatever pristine we can say on our planet at this point, but primary forests. And what I think is a really important next step will be to go to forests that have been fragmented, trees that might have been isolated, plantation forests, and to try to understand structure and diversity in those types of forests as well. I think we need to go beyond looking at taxonomic diversity, but also to recognize these many other kinds of diversities that exist in tropical cloud forests. Thank you very much.
For the graph that you showed with the surviving species, was that the worst case scenario or best case scenario?
That was based on, Chris Still in 1999 published a paper in Nature concerning his predictions for global climate change and tropical montane forests. And basically said that there will be an extension of the dry season and that mist and fog would be considerably lowered. And the best approximation that we could do for that in terms of allowing epiphytes to experience those conditions were to move epiphytes down the mountain from their current place in the upper cloud forest, where we did experience and we did made measurements actually of mist input and soil moisture with little gypsum blocks. So we were able to monitor the fact that, yes, it was considerably drier and there was consistently less mist. Those predictions were based on a doubling of CO2 in the next 20 years. And, of course, it would be better to be able to sort of monitor those more closely in growth chambers or something like that, but we felt that at least that was a first shot in terms of approximating what was predicted under those climatic conditions.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, there's one in the very back. We haven't had any.
I'm very interested in this possibility of using it in man-affected landscapes, and I'm wondering whether, in a sense, you could start to do computer models where people want to do more conservation-oriented forestry, whether you could start to say, well, with this type of tree in this area, you're very limited, you know, and start to play around on paper for conservation, where conservation can meet up with forestry.
That's a really good question. As I said, there are so few studies that have been done in man-made situations. We don't have a lot to draw from in terms of just something as simple as how long does it take epiphytes to colonize. There are a few studies that have looked at grapefruit plantations or cacao plantations and have looked at bromeliads, for example. So those are the few data that we would work from in terms of trying to do what you're saying. One piece that we're trying to work on, my colleagues and I are now trying to work on, is setting up, we have set up what we call the Big Canopy Database, the Canopy Database Project. We have support from the National Science Foundation, and we're trying to pull in as many canopy data sets as we can, both for the purposes of visualization and analysis, as well as modeling, as you suggest. You can't really do modeling without a large base of data. So the first step in that is to provide a structure whereby canopy data sets can be pulled in and compared. So I think that's something that we're heading for in the future, but doesn't exist at this point.
I just see myself as the light relief today, coming down from the canopy to Earth, if you like. Because I'm not a scientist, I see myself as an interpreter. I write books and I have been on many, many expeditions and tried to understand what the hell's going on with all those scientists doing their clever things that you're hearing about from all the other geniuses here. I also wear a great many hats, and I might have been talking about a totally different subject, because much of my exploring life has been spent visiting indigenous people, different tribes in different parts of the world, all through the 50s and 60s and 70s, and indeed 80s. And I've lived and stayed with more than 100 different indigenous groups in different parts of the world, and was one of the founders of Survival International, which I'm now president of, and there's some stuff on it over there, and I've got some more literature, and we've got some seminars on it next week, and indeed Simon Counsell is going to be speaking about that just after me and next. So I'm not really talking about indigenous people. What I'm going to talk to you about is one of the ways in which this whole business that we're all talking about now began. Because in the mid-1970s, nearly 30 years ago, I was invited by the then director of the Royal Geographical Society, John Hemming, who's coming tomorrow, in fact, to the conversation, to lead what turned into the biggest scientific expedition ever to leave this country, and to go and find out where this expedition should take place in Borneo. And at first, I wanted it to be about indigenous people, about the Penang. But it soon became clear that we were not going to be allowed to do that because of the attitude of the Malaysian government. They were rather sensitive on that subject. And so we started putting a multidisciplinary scientific expedition together. And after looking around all the four states that constitute Borneo, third biggest island in the world, very densely rainforested then in the mid-70s, we settled on an area in Sarawak here called Mulu, which was the largest national park in Sarawak and had just been gazetted. It's a close-up of Mulu. It's 90 miles upriver, up the Baram and the Tuta River, and tucked in behind Brunei, and it's a large area with every known form of tropical rainforest in it, which is why we chose it, ranging from 100 feet up to 800 feet above sea level, and everything except mangrove swamp we didn't have. But it was a long and difficult place to get to up there and very isolated. And we put together this expedition, which ran in 1977-78, and in this wonderful environment. It's the biggest piece of limestone in Southeast Asia. There are limestone mountains up to 5,000 feet and then a sandstone Mulu mountain itself up to 8,000 feet. It's incredibly diverse and was surrounded, the park, with a large buffer area of also untouched virgin forest down towards the Brunei border, which sadly has now all gone. That's looking into the limestone. Just to give you an idea of scale on all that, Beachy Head, our highest white cliff of Dover, which people jump off from time to time, is 300 feet high. These white cliffs are 3,000 feet high in places. And the diversity and interest of the limestone, cast limestone habitat is fascinating. This is looking out from near our base camp over pristine rainforest up into the limestone mountain, Gunung Api, with Mulu, Mount Mulu behind. Getting there was very difficult, difficult getting 3 days by river, going upstream in these long boats. I actually managed to acquire a jet boat, which I could do it in 3 hours in, which was great fun, picking up new scientists and whizzing them into the middle of the rainforest. We had a great diversity of scientists with us, and we had to look after them. It says 140 in the program. Actually, there were between 120 and 130 scientists and 10 or 15 of us who looked after them. It was a new form of expedition. It changed the culture, where either scientists went off and had to do everything themselves, which some still have to do in the rainforest, and spend an awful lot of time looking after themselves, or you had the rather traditional British big expedition with my very good friend John Blashford Snell and people like that, who were a lot of soldiers who went off and had a jolly time in the rainforest or wherever, and tacked a few scientists on for respectability. What we did was, great man, but you know, a different philosophy. Anyway, what we did was to make science king, and we looked after the scientists in every possible way for the time that they were there. Some were there for 3 or 4 weeks, a few for the whole 15 months. We, the admin staffs, were there for the whole 15 months. And the first thing I did was to build a longhouse, which was terrific fun, but modelled on the people who were going to be working for us, the Barawan people. I got them to build the longhouse, just measured it out with a bit of string and a bit of rainforest right on the edge of the park. And it could sleep up to 60 people at a time when they came, and BBC came and filmed, and others came and went. And we could get up there by river. It's about 14 miles from the nearest other longhouse. And after we left, we removed and burnt everything and it reverted to forest again. We also built sub-camps, which are, some of which are still there, out of bilion wood. We got great help from helicopters and dropped the bilion timbers in on the tops of the mountains at different altitudes. And those are still the research sites that people can go and I hope work in, but it's now just tourists who go there sometimes. We had temporary camps like this out in the forest, and we where we would work, and we had little tiny camps like this on the top of Gunungapi, which we were trying to climb. That was my little camp when I almost made the top on my own on one occasion, and we did eventually do the first ascent on it. And that's looking out over towards the Brunei border, a huge area, and that's on limestone. The scientists had to be got out into the field, and we developed various philosophies about how to do rainforest research, bearing in mind we wanted that this was multidisciplinary, which was a sort of new idea for me, and I had to work out what it meant, which meant knocking disparate scientists' head together and making them work in these sub-camps with scientists of a different ilk from what they were used to working in. It worked terribly well. We'd put a botanist and a zoologist spitting fire together in one of these remote camps, leave them there for a fortnight to do their various work, and they'd come back discovering that the plant that the botanist was studying was actually propagated by the insect that the lepidopterist was studying, and they were friends for life, and all sorts of biodiversity in human relationship terms developed as a result of that philosophy. And sending them off into the sub-camps, we'd go off in these upriver as far as we could and then walk for a day or so, and they would stay there for 2 weeks and then come back for some R&R at the base camp where we had doctors and nurses and same-day laundry service in the river and so on to make their lives as easy as possible so that they could concentrate as much as possible on doing what was necessary, which was their scientific research. This is Mark Collins, who is now, I've forgotten what it's called, he's just moved to Nairobi to be head of the UNEP, can you remember, Ian?
World Conservation Monitoring Centre.
Well, he was the World Conservation Monitoring Centre in Cambridge, he was head of, went on to become head of, and he's now head of the UNEP department in Nairobi. And there he is working in the field in the sub-camp. The philosophy was, let's go back on that one, that we always appointed, as soon as a scientist arrived, I would appoint a couple of locals, and we had 150 of them also over the period working for us, either working with the scientists who would both look after them, show them how to live in the forest, put the shelters up, bring them tea in the morning, make sure they didn't get lost or killed or anything, and also help them in their scientific work. And it would vary depending on the sort of scientific work they were doing, which sort of people we had. If they were soil scientists carrying great heavy lumps of rock around and doing geophysical studies, then they might have two or three Barawans who are very tough longhouse people. If they were botanists or entomologists or whatever, very often they would find better to have a Panan working with them, who are the hunter-gatherers of the forest, I'll come to in a minute. And so they always had people working with them in the field like that. Here's Jeremy Holloway, who author of Moths of Borneo, and doing his collection, and huge amount of work was done in the evenings analysing and sorting all the plants. So these amorphous groups would set out into the forest. We had 10 different nations taking part as scientists, and 30% of the people on the expedition were Malaysian. And that's an American, and Barawans, and Penang. And indeed, the young man on the end there, and if he's back in here, has gone out, was one of our young scientists who we had the idea of sending him off to investigate one of the nicer things about living in that part of the rainforest, which was the wonderful dawn chorus of the gibbons, the whoop, 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 which we could hear, the wonderful sounds of the gibbon. So young Andrew Mitchell went and sat for ages up as close as he could get to the canopy counting gibbons. And I like to think that I started all this by suggesting that Andrew should go and count gibbons in the canopy, and that gave him the idea, which is why we're all here now. Yeah. However, that's Andrew, a much younger Andrew, going off with his team into the forest. The man who was behind it all, the great genius who gazetted the park, was the Deputy Conservator the Conservator of Forests, as it was then called, in Borneo, Rob Anderson, a wonderful man, died just recently, and he was the inspirator of it all. He didn't like people much. He used to be out by himself usually in a camp, and was rather horrified by some of the miscoordinated scientists we brought in, because we had an age range of 75 down to two. One brought their children, and a lot of girls on it. He didn't approve of that at all. But he would do his work out in the field, and it was his idea, and he it was who told me that that was where we should have the expedition. The the scientific genius behind it all, who put the whole package together, was Clive Jeremy, a firm man from the Natural History Museum, under whose auspices we were, and Clive organised the scientific programme, which developed hugely, far, far bigger than we ever expected it would over the time, so that there were tens of thousands of new species discovered and analysed and recorded and written about as a result of the expedition. Probably the most important of all our multifarious activities was, and is much talked about in this conference, was the Forest Ecology Programme, which was led by John Proctor. And he started doing what I like in simple terms to think was the key role that this expedition played, which was to actually work out how the rainforest worked, how it operated, how you could have this incredibly rich biodiversity and richness, this huge cabbage patch growing on what is effectively a desert. We all know there's no the soil isn't much good underneath. And he, I like to think, was one of the pioneers for cracking the code of how that worked by working out how the nutrients are all retained, as you all know, in the forest, and how by catching huge quantities of litter, which he collected in bags made by prisoners at Exeter Prison, which we brought out, huge amounts of leaf litter, and analysing them and finding out how rapidly they were reabsorbed into the plants, and the nutrients were then dragged back up into the canopy. We also did a tremendous amount of work, obviously, on symbiotic relationships, which you're hearing a lot about, like ant plants, which you then cut in half and find that how it works, that the ant protects the plant and the plant provides the habitat for the ant that you all know about, all that sort of thing. And a fascinating area for, I've forgotten what they're called now.
Pitcher plant.
What's the Latin? Nepenthes. Thank you very much. I never forget words, but I forgot Nepenthes. Wonderful area for Nepenthes. Masses of them all over the forest floor, up in the higher areas. And these beautiful ones, which I think it was Hose described as making a fine claret jug. You can put about 2.5 pints in one of those, or a litre. Very interesting habitat as well in the forest, of course, because in those little, although they're rainforest, it rained like billy all the time, there was very often no water there when you were away from the streams and the rivers. And these provide little ecosystems where all sorts of interesting things went on, which our scientists studied. They found a frog which bred in the bottom of one of those pitcher plants. This is quite a big one, looking into it, and if you sink to the bottom, you get digested, of course, by the pitcher plant. But this one has, if you can just see, a spider sitting on the end, which for some reason, which had developed, that it didn't slip in like everything else that flies along attracted by it and then slips down and into the water, into the liquid, and is digested. This spider lives on the edge, and when a fly lands plop in the water, the spider will dive in after the fly and catch it. Fly thinks, oh good, there's a lifeguard in this pitcher plant, I'm going to be rescued, and the spider will then drag the fly up to the side and eat it. But all sorts of extraordinary things were discovered in there, like the frogs that were there, which actually laid their tadpoles in there, which turned into little baby frogs, and somehow again managed to get out. Frogs. Just a very quick I won't pretend to tell all the scientists here what all these things are or what their Latin names are. I'll leave you to tell me. But that's a little flying frog which turns its 4 feet into parachutes. And we did some fascinating work on land crabs. There were lots of land crabs which didn't have numbers on their backs when we got there, but we dug little troughs all over the place, put plastic buckets in. They're very difficult to find and to catch, but by putting little buckets all over, little pots, little sort of ice cream cartons all over the place, sunk into the forest, every crab that was caught had a number painted on it, and then you could tell whether they learned lessons or came back and got caught again, and how many there were, and stuff like that. Birds, we had an amazing lot of very good top people on the expedition, many of whom have become very famous subsequently. The Birdman was from the American, from the Metropolitan Museum, from the National History Museum in New York, Ben King, great collector of birds. It has a huge bird list, Mulu. Unfortunately, the book's out of print, but the book that I subsequently wrote about it has all this information in it. And I can never remember scientific details, but there's something like 400-450 species recorded, including Ben King was there very interested in recording the eighth frog mouth in Borneo. There were seven recorded. He was sure there was another one. He spent 3 weeks sitting in the rain under a tree with a Barawan. I tried to get him permission to bring a gun into Borneo, but it was refused. So he found a local with a large blunderbuss, sat under this tree for 3 weeks in the pouring rain, and finally shot. It was the only time I gave permission for anything to be killed, apart from some wild boar that we lived on, pigs. He shot indeed the eighth frogmouth, and possibly the last of its species, and that is now in the Natural History Museum in New York. He was frightfully pleased about that. That's a little kingfisher, by the way, that we just see. Lots of mammals not seen very much up in the canopies, spectral tarsia, which on the whole one only sees, and this is why the canopy is so important, when people cut the trees down. And not far away there was a logging camp, and this little tarsia was actually brought in from the logging camp having come down. Some very interesting pioneering work done on the floor of the forest by David MacDonald, who was at Oxford, on the first radio tracking of animals in the forest. He's well known for his work on foxes and British mammals, but he radio tracked civet cats and learnt a lot about their activities and about how you do radio tracking in the forest. Masses of little bugs, bone-feeding bugs. I think that one has a luminous nose. I'm sure somebody will be able to tell me what it is. Little beetles. The don with a luminous nose. Yes, well, we called it the don with luminous nose. beetles, and caterpillars of all sorts, turned into butterflies of all sorts, the Rajabrook birdwing, which loved our latrines. We were very ecologically sensible there. We had reprocessed everything, but the butterflies did love our bombs at the back of the latrines, which we buried and closed everything up at the end. Rhododendrons, lots of new species of those, particularly growing up on the higher limestone mountains. And lovely things, orchids of various sorts. I'm just going to whip through these because I'm trying to go faster so as we catch up a bit of the time we've lost. Fungi were fascinating. We had a marvellous man from Walter Crinny, what's he called? Belgium, Dutch University, who was studying the fungi, and he, which were enormous, it had never been studied in that part in Borneo at all. It was practically virgin territory he was in. And on the first day when he came back, and he was actually working out of base camp, and he came back in and I said, "How are you doing? Have you found anything new?" And he said, "Yes, I have found 100 species, 100 specimens." I said, "Oh, good, anything new?" "Yes, 60% is new to science." Well, this is pretty good. But he did it for 3 weeks, and the percentage never dropped. Well, this is the sort of thing we've been hearing about. So at the end, when he was leaving, after only 3 weeks, having collected an enormous number of specimens, which in our little laboratory there, he dried and preserved and was taken back to Leiden, I think it was, he was going. And I said, "So where are you off to next? Where's your next scientific expedition?" He said, "No, the rest of my life will be spent in analysing what I have collected here." Oh, you know, eye-opener for non-scientists. I do admire you. The dangers of the forest, it's not a dangerous place, as I'm sure you all know who've been there. It's a wonderful habitat, the rainforest. Very few things to be frightened of. Snakes, certainly, least of our fears. This was a pit viper that sapped. They are very poisonous, but they're very lethargic as well. And this one sat for 3 days next to a hole that the geomorphologists were digging, barely looking up. This is the nastiest thing, certainly, in the Borneo rainforest, and the most to be feared, the centipede. I reckon they're the bad guys. Two or three people were bitten by them. They had a tendency to go into our nest in our underwear in the longhouse. And so you wanted to shake it out well before you put it on. A couple of people made a mistake. And one of the women who did it said it was much worse than childbirth. And the doctor, who, at the time, there were two doctors, a husband and wife team there. And the wife, I saw, she was helping out in the kitchen at the time, 5 o'clock in the morning. I was just coming back from swimming in the river. And I saw her shake the kitchen towel out and suddenly go, ha! Ouch! And I knew that, I could see the centipede scuttle off and it had just bitten her on the arm. And so I went and woke her husband up. And she was half laughing and half crying because she knew she was going into a very unpleasant period. And I woke him up and he knocked her out for 12 hours. Which handy to have a husband who's a doctor with you. And by the time she came round, the pain was over. But not all of us were that lucky. These were the good guys, I reckon, the millipedes. So John Proctor told me. And a lot of our talk was about how they are integral to reprocessing all the litter on the forest floor and turning the nutrient and reprocessing the nutrients so they get back into the canopy. And perfectly harmless, of course. It was an astonishing environment. This area of 50 metre high cast limestone pinnacles became the logo for the Mulu area. And we did a lot of work and measurement in there, and it was a jolly difficult place to get into. And they're razor sharp and an extraordinary area, but it got the cast geomorphologists very excited. And although it's not what we should be talking about today, just as a passing interest, we also discovered, because we had a speleological team who came out of splendid cavers, top best cavers in the world, they all come from the North Country. And they're all either miners or plumbers for some reason, and they're small, little people, and very, very brave and very wise. And they were terribly excited because they knew there were caves here, and it ended up that they found the biggest cave system in the world, which we had there. And they're fantastic caves, which go right through the whole of this mountain. And I'll just show you some pictures. That's a bit dark in here, but that's what I put a picture of me in. That's me up there to give scale. You could get St. Paul's Cathedral five times into this cave. It's the biggest river passage cave in the world, the Deer Cave. And inside the mountain, we found caves up to 5 kilometres deep inside the mountain with these rivers. There's a 50-kilometre long river, the Clearwater, which is here, wonderful rock structures and so on. And the biggest cave, which they found actually after the expedition, but they went back again, the Sarawak Chamber, if you look in your Guinness Book of Records, you will see is the biggest entirely enclosed cave in the world. It's 5 kilometres inside the mountain, and you could put Wembley Stadium in it twice, and it's inside the mountain. Mind blowing. And that's the Clearwater River. We had boats and had a wonderful time. I spent days down under the river with the cavers. Very exciting sleeping down there and covering these huge distances. Enormous. Stalic might reach the top, and stalactites, which come down. Remember how that goes. And of course, the biology inside the caves was fascinating. I'm told that having a blind white crab with no eyes means that they must have been isolated from light for something between 3 and 5 million years in order to have evolved like that. And then there were other things which had evolved more recently to go white, but which has still had some residual colour, and it's all caused, the biology inside these extraordinary caves, by the 2 million bats, free-tailed bats, which fly out every evening in great clouds like this, and the million or so swiftlets which fly in at the same time. So there's a wonderful traffic jam in the mouths of all these caves, and as a result, lots of guano, which create lots of interesting life inside the caves. And actually, there's lots I shouldn't I've got time to say about the way in which these bats, which went enormous distances every day to feed even as far away as the coast on the Sonoratia, the mangrove swamps, and were integral in another fascinating symbiotic relationship in propagating both mangroves and durian and other things which need to go through all these complicated processes. I believe a durian also has to pass through a monkey in order to germinate. So if you get rid of the monkeys and you get rid of the bats, you don't have any more durian, which are the favourite fruits of people. Very, very good, if you like that sort of thing. I like durian, not everybody likes them, they smell very nice. Now my particular interest and why I'd wanted to go originally and do this work there was to find the Penan and work with them. We were told, I was told by no other less authority than Tom Harrison, when I saw him just before we went, that there were no more nomadic Penan left in Borneo. But we started seeing signs of them around the camp. And the first couple of months, the Barawans who were working with us said, oh yes, there are Penan there, but they haven't, we haven't seen them yet. And then one day, this man, wearing a bark loincloth, carrying a spear, a blowpipe, and a quiver, and nothing else, walked into base camp when I was there by myself, and became my great friend. I went back with him to his family, which were a day's trot away through the forest, stayed the night with them, and they were Penan who had not had any contact. He'd been all over the place and had done a lot of things. 3 minutes, I'm finishing now, and right at the end. And he and his family came back and stayed with us. We met up to 450 other Penan in that area, who some of whom came and used our medical services and our doctors. Nyapun's own family came and settled near the base camp, used 10 of them, 10 children, all used to come and join on my Brazilian hammock. It's not moving on. I'll give it a hit, sorry. Oh, I don't like being hit. They usually respond well to being hit. Sorry about that. I've just been told I've got 3 minutes left. Time is precious. Any good, Joy? Anyway, the Penan, just to carry on talking while John fixes it, used to spend that time with us, and it meant that I could travel around the forest absolutely safely with Nyapun, because he would show me. He was totally at home there. And it's a tragic story as what's happened since. And my saddest moment was leaving them at the end, when knowing what was going to happen to them after we had gone. And indeed, it is tragic what's happened. I have a picture, which we may get, of the destruction of the forest, but you have seen lots of those, which has continued in the 28 years since we were there. I'm sorry to say that the destruction or the whole of the surrounding, there's one caught in there. You have to pull it out. Yeah, click it out, pull this thing. Let you push that, lift it out. I'm going to have to get around to modern technology, pull that one out, shove it in. Go backwards, I should. The sad thing is that the area all around has been clear felled. There's still one in there, by the look of it. The buffer zone all around the Mulu National Park has gone, and the park itself is still there and is fine, and we made a film for Channel 4 about it a couple of years ago. But the sad thing is that there's been no further scientific research. It was far and away the best researched rainforest in the world when we left it, with all these studies and reports and the scientific evidence that's still coming out. Fast forward. It's now just a place that people go to look at the caves and to see what see the beauties of the place without doing any further scientific research. And one of the things we're trying to do is to get work to continue that. Anyway, there we are, back with the Penan. Keep going. I'll take over. Oh, Lord. It's packed up. Anyway, forget about the slides. my time is up. The sad thing is that there's been no further research. The important thing is to get the research continued back there. It's a wonderful place. I recommend it. We took a group of friends of the project there a couple of years ago who had a very nice time. It's a comfortable hotel there now where base camp used to be. And it's a wonderful way of experience. It's not far from the Danum Valley, and you can research like we've heard about, and you can do both on one visit. So I hope that's given you some idea of what it's like to run a huge rainforest expedition and start the whole ball rolling. What I'm also interested in is that since then, I spent the last 25 years campaigning and in all sorts of ways to stop the destruction of the rainforest, largely ineffectually, and I hope that we will hear from Ian Swingland later how maybe there are other solutions to the rainforest than trying to stop governments cutting it down, which they won't, by trying to raise enough money from conservation, which is impossible. Perhaps there is a commercial answer to the problem, but we'll hear about that from Ian later. Sorry for going on so long.
Well, thank you very much, Ian. I'm particularly honoured to be following straight on from Robin Hanbury-Tenison, who, despite his rather modest self-introduction, has probably, in my opinion, done more than any other single person to bring to wider public attention the fate of the world's indigenous peoples. Now, we've heard this morning from several of the speakers a mention of the importance of people within the rainforest and their relationship to the forest canopy. And what I'd like to do in my short presentation is to try and explore some of these issues and to go on to consider what might be some of the implications of the role of people for the way that we study and the way that we aim to conserve those rainforests in the future. Well, one of the great achievements of the Eden Project, of course, has been to bring a rainforest experience to many hundreds of thousands of people, people who may, unlike us, never have the opportunity to visit a real rainforest. And this conference, I think, provides an appropriate and a very unique opportunity to consider this role of people within what is actually now considered as the last true Eden on Earth. Curiously, and despite the Bible's original mythical location of humankind within Eden, modern conceptions and metaphors for Eden often define it as a space, an ecosystem unsullied by humans, and a wilderness to be protected against plundering by humanity. Of course, now as a modern Western society, we often define ourselves, our greed, our vanity, and our technical knowledge as the prime agent in the destruction of the Earth's most bountiful ecosystem. But I'll argue that the conception of the rainforest as an uninhabited Eden is not only erroneous, but it's actually quite dangerous. And it's, in my opinion, very much a construct of the recent international conservation movement with actually very little precedent in historical or cultural reality. I personally find it tempting to interpret the Eden myth as a transcription of a dimly recorded oral history, a story passed down generation to generation over possibly thousands of years, recounting the transition of us, humanity, Homo sapiens, to primitive agriculturalists from hunter-gatherer, a condition in which all of humanity was at some stage in our past. Whatever our interpretations of Genesis chapters 2 and 3, modern scientific studies, whether from an anthropological or a structural, a sociological, or an energetic perspective, have tended to support the basic view of hunter-gatherer societies freely eating from the fruits of the forest, from the fruits of the orchard, I'm quoting the Bible, which swarms with creatures, many of which, of course, it transpires, make a very tasty dinner. And this life of the bountiful life of hunter-gatherers is to be compared with life in early agricultural societies, a desperate struggle against thorns and thistles, as the Bible describes it, which, as we now know, was often nasty, brutish, violent, and very short. Some of the distinguished participants in this conference, including Professor Prantz, have made some seminal advances in Western science's understanding of the relationship between hunting-gathering forest societies and their environment. But actually, our knowledge of the ecology of such societies remains desperately scant. Dr. Daryl Posey, in his studies of the Kayapo, as pictured here, of the eastern Amazon rainforest, was one of the few scientists that have investigated the ecological relationship between a rainforest people and the forest in which they live. The Kayapo actually inhabit largely the rainforest savanna, Cerrado, border. Within the forest, small patches are cleared of large vegetation and planted with species useful for food, medicines, and building and ritual purposes. The plots that are cleared and replanted in this way can be intensely cultivated for years using a very complex pattern of fertilization, sympathetic planting, and irrigation before natural regeneration, and I use that term natural with some caution, is allowed to take over. The Kayapo don't actually abandon their forest gardens, as they call them, but return to them over many years as these gardens continue to produce fruit and medicines and form a habitat for wild game. Very significantly, I think, the Kayapo don't actually distinguish between cultivation and natural environment. What we perceive as forest is considered by the Kayapo as old fields. And added to these patches of old fields within what we consider to be the forest, there are also trails of up to 4 meters wide, crisscrossing the forest, which are constantly enriched by the Kayapo with their preferred species. But the Kayapo's ecological engineering, as Daryl Posey termed it, in the savannah, is perhaps even more significant. Often starting at an old ant's nest, which may be particularly rich in various soil nutrients, the Kayapo introduce plants from parts of the forest with similar microecological conditions into usually a 1 to 2 meter diameter area. And working out from this in concentric rings, more than 100 species might be planted into what eventually form a forest island, which is rich in these useful plants for the Kayapo, for foods, for medicinal plants, for shade, wildlife attracting species, and plants that can provide fresh water. And it's been found that, staggeringly, these forest islands of around 10 hectares or so can contain plant varieties collected and transposed from an area the size of Western Europe. And if you look at this picture, probably can just pick out rather dimly down here in the bottom right hand corner what appear to be these concentric rings of forest islands, and this is a Kayapo village here. And I think this kind of image actually challenges our very notion of what is a forest and what is a natural forest. This is possibly wetland here. This is savanna. This is forest. Is this savanna becoming forest? Was this forest here created by the Kayapo over many, many hundreds or possibly thousands of years? And we have actually no reason to believe that the Kayapo are unique. And this anthropogenic selection, this human-made selection of species, in some ways a cultivation of Eden on a continental scale, has had profound impacts on what we now consider to be the canopy of the unspoilt wilderness of Amazonia. And there's actually some evidence that indicates that the Congo Basin rainforests, what we now perceive to be virgin forest, may also have been the product of hundreds or thousands of years of a totally unrecorded human modification. Carbon layers within the soil profiles in large areas of the Congo suggest that fire, possibly of human origination, has created the conditions in which the abundance of the rainforest is now possible. And virtually all of the Congo Basin rainforest has been inhabited for 3,000 years or so, or was until the colonial period when a lot of it was deliberately depopulated, and much of it is still claimed as traditional territory. And in fact, we still see essentially the same rotational forest gardening taking place today as probably started about 5,000 years or so when the arrival in that part of the world of banana plants from Asia enabled Bantu farmers to start migrating in towards the Congo forest, or the region that is now the Congo forest. So perhaps we owe it to the Kayapo in the Amazon Basin, the Bayaka pygmies in the Congo Basin, and many other forest peoples for their selective gathering, hunting, planting, fertilizing, and rotational forest agriculture, that we now have such a diverse and wondrous space in which to launch our canopy rafts and explore on our aerial walkways. Yet I think it's worth reflecting that in some conceptions of conservation, this human agency is anathematized as destructive, even though ironically, now, without contention, we accept that our traditional methods of forest management in this country are an integral part of maintaining the ecological diversity of our own forests here. if the eco-historical relationship between indigenous forest people and their environment is profound, then it should be of no surprise that the forest continues to play an important role in providing those people with crucial resources. Again, our detailed knowledge of these relationships is rather scant, but we're at least beginning to understand how some of these economies of the canopy work. One of the great canopy trees of the Congo Basin rainforest is the Mwabi, which can grow up to 60 metres tall and about 5 metres in diameter. For Bantu villages and Baka pygmies, particularly for women in fact, Mwabi is an important plant in economic, cultural and medicinal terms. And you'll see this man here holding the fruit of a Mwabi tree. Mwabi fruits are highly sought after, in fact, and as well as being a good food source, the seeds yield oil used for cooking and lighting. Extracts of the bark provide medications for a range of conditions, including dental and back problems, and a very effective foot bath to ease sore feet after a long day walking in the forest. And I can tell you that it works because I've tried it. And here we see Jacques Ngun, who is a Baka pygmy from southern Cameroon, actually removing some of the bark from a Mwabi tree. Another canopy resource important to the people of the Congo Basin rainforest is the sapele tree. And like Mwabi, sapele provides medicines, including treatments for headaches, bacterial infections, and eye complaints. But more importantly, large emergent sapele trees are also the unique host of the Imbrasia caterpillar, a highly regarded local delicacy. And I'm sorry that I don't actually have a picture of this to show you, but I believe that in the exhibition of photographs by Kate Eshelby, which is somewhere around the Eden Project at the moment, there are some lovely pictures of Mbanjeli pygmy people in the north of Congo with some of these sapele caterpillars, and you'll gather from that the importance that, that these caterpillars play in these people's lives. And these are a highly valued item in local trade, and they're very easy to dry and preserve. And the collecting of these caterpillars is a communal task, providing a really important source of income for women and the elderly. In fact, these examples of indigenous canopy economies are very numerous, and they're very varied. Extracts of the seeds of the greenheart tree, used by Amerindian women in Guyana as a very reliable contraceptive. Ilipi nuts from various Southeast Asian shoria species, trees used in cooking, also for oils and fats, and also medicine. Wild honey, also collected for medicinal and culinary purposes, collected from high in the forest canopy, usually with astounding skill and bravery, by Baka pygmies. My examples are in fact deliberately chosen. As well as playing an important role in local economies, all of these trees, Mwabi, sapele, greenheart, shoria, usually known as Maranti, are all also felled for their timber and traded internationally. And the felling of these particular tree species can have devastating impacts on local people. In the case of Mwabi, for example, it provides one of the few sustainable sources of cash income currently available to pygmy people in many areas. But the Mwabi tree only starts to flower after it's about 50 or 70 years old, and then it only flowers every 3 years or so. So it is very vulnerable to extinction from indiscriminate logging, and Mwabi timber is being logged, mostly exported to Britain and Europe. But estimates have suggested that the revenues gained from sustainable production of Mwabi oil, perhaps over centuries, on a sustainable basis, can be greater, even over a 10-year period, than the one-off sale of that Mwabi tree for its timber. Sapele wood is also another timber that we encounter frequently in this country, used as a veneer on low-quality internal doors, often used, in fact, only for a few years before being thrown away or burned. And this willful waste can actually mean starvation to the forest inhabitants. The sapele caterpillar season occurs only during the rainy periods, when game is difficult to hunt and fishing is unsuccessful and the next season's crops haven't yet matured. And studies have shown that during these very lean periods, 75% of the protein eaten by pygmies at this time is from the sapele caterpillars. It's interesting, when I was doing, in terms of the way that we perceive these trees and the resources within the forest, I did a Google internet search on Moabi and Sapelia a couple of days ago, and I found that one has to scan through scores, hundreds of references to the mechanical properties of the timber of Moabi and the timber of Sapelia, adverts for luxury flooring products and pictures of planks of wood, before coming to a single reference to each of those timbers as an essential, vital resource to those local people. But the rainforest is not important just to people who live directly in the forest. In the Democratic Republic of Congo, for example, some 35 million people out of a total population there of about 55 million are dependent for their livelihoods and well-being on forest resources. And for them, and they are the poorest people on earth, living on less than $90 a year on average, the loss of the forest resources for them can literally be a matter of life and death. Of course, ever since European society's first contacts with the natives of tropical lands, we have been learning from them the value of the environment which they have nurtured and adapted, as indicated in this image of the first moments of encounter between Columbus and the Taino people in the island of what was known then as Hispaniola. Most famously, in 1638, the Countess of Chinchon, the wife of Spain's viceroy in Peru, was cured of a malaria-like fever with an infusion made from the bark of a tree found on the slopes of the Andes, a fever cure that was widely used by the Amerindians. The precise nature of Peru bark extract was not fully understood, in fact, for 250 years or so later, but Cinchona gave hope against what was, at the time, Europe's single biggest killer, malaria. And quinine, when eventually isolated, was in fact the first chemical compound to be successfully used to treat an infectious disease. Other examples include curare, which was reportedly discovered when in 1542, one of the men on a mission with Spanish explorer Francisco de Orellana, who we see on the left there, or a bust of him on the left there, died from a tiny skin wound inflicted during an attack by Indians on the Napo River. Curare was and still is used as a poison in hunting by indigenous people, such as this Warani man shown in the middle there, but is also now important in advanced Western medicine, being used as a muscle relaxant during major surgery. The cultural practices and belief systems of forest people often serve to ensure that their society remains broadly within the ecological limits of the surrounding forest. The Yaka hunter-gatherer pygmies in northern Congo, for example, have a saying that a Yaka loves the forest as he loves his own body. For the indigenous peoples of the upper Amazon rainforest, such as the Ashaninka, use of potent hallucinogenic ayahuasca, which is derived from a vine, under strict guidance by shamans, can not only connect them to the spirit world, but also provide them with deep insights into what they consider to be the true nature of the plants and animals around them. And in this unusual painting by the ayahuasca artist Pablo Amaringo, you will notice the three different spirits representing three different types of tree, each of which has a distinct humanized characteristic with which the shaman associates that tree. You'll notice in the middle here and down at the bottom there, the snakes, which are almost omnipresent in ayahuasca visions, and which are important as symbols of the very life force itself, and often appear in coiled pairs, which has drawn some observers to draw parallels between these symbols of life force and our own conceptualization of the molecular structure of DNA. And in the bottom right hand corner, the shape of the trees down here reflect the shape of the human beings undertaking this ayahuasca ritual, representing the transcendence and the transformation of the matter of the people into the matter of the trees and back and forth over time. Oh yeah, and here's an interesting thing. an early artist sketch of the Eden project? Actually, no. It's another painting made by a Peruvian ayahuasquero, illustrating a hidden fabric, as it is perceived by him, of interconnections within his forest surroundings. Now we've, I believe, barely begun to understand these deeper cultural phenomena through which forest people's knowledge of their environment is mediated. But we should try to understand that for most, if not all, indigenous forest dwellers, these insights into the forest are as self-evident as is our confidence that the wondrous structures we see here at Eden and the motorways and the high-speed railways that brought us here will still be there tomorrow. As with the revelations about indigenous ecological knowledge, we would do well not to dismiss them. And we should reflect that as these peoples and their cultures are driven into extinction, so they take with them into extinction their knowledge and their nurturing of the forest. So to recap then, and to make a few conclusions, much of what we perceive, I believe, as virgin rainforest may well actually have undergone significant modification by indigenous people, or even be the product of their cultures. Where these cultures still exist, they often have a profound understanding of the forest's function and ecology. And to many, it still plays a crucial role in their lives, their livelihoods and survival. And Western scientists, and perhaps all of us still, perhaps have much to learn from them. It seems obvious then that when we consider how we will conserve the forest for the future, be it for research, for leisure, for biodiversity, or for production of valuable resources, these people should be an integral and an important part of our plans. But sadly, this has not always been the case. Many early efforts at large-scale conservation of rainforests adopted a Western, specifically a US model of strictly protected areas and wilderness national parks, actually conveniently forgetting that, as with many areas of tropical rainforest, some of the great national parks of North America were very much the product of thousands of years of indigenous land management. In many parts of the tropics, the best protected areas have been those where indigenous people have fiercely resisted the incursions of loggers, of cattle ranchers, mining companies, and invading colonists. And these areas have been very attractive as ready-made conservation areas. The result of this has been repeated conflicts, in fact, in which international conservation organizations have effectively muscled in on indigenous lands, in some cases deliberately undermining traditional authorities and cultures and replacing them with modern technocratic management. At worst, indigenous peoples have seen their traditional land management practices condemned, their farms destroyed, their subsistence bushmeat confiscated, and their settlements destroyed or relocated outside the park boundaries. Now, much has been said in recent years, fortunately, about collaboration between conservationists and indigenous people, but actually, in my opinion, rather little appears to have changed on the ground. A recent survey carried out by Professor Michael Cernia, who's a professor of anthropology at George Washington University, found that in 12 protected areas in the Congo Basin rainforests, a total of some 54,000 people, including Bantu farmers and various pygmy groups, had been evicted or had had their lands expropriated by conservation organizations. This picture here shows Batwa pygmy people living in makeshift camps near the town of Bukavu in eastern Congo, having first been forcibly expelled from the Kahuzi Biega National Park and then afflicted by the area's persistent civil unrest. And the many thousands of Batwa who have so suffered these forcible expulsions are not included in that figure of 54,000 that I quoted a moment ago. These conservation refugees, as is what they are effectively, who were photographed just earlier this year, are, I think, living testimony that we still have a very long way to go in reconciling conservation with indigenous people's rights. And just to let you know, my own organization, the Rainforest Foundation, is working to try and help these people, first of all, to come to terms and deal with the critical situation that they now find themselves in, and then as a longer-term prospect to try and help them re-establish rights within some of the areas from which they have been previously evicted. I was very heartened to hear Professor Kitching earlier today talking about the need for local ownership by local communities. And I think apart from abuses of international human rights standards, an anti-people approach to conservation may be counterproductive even in terms of biodiversity protection. As Professor Sonia has pointed out, and I quote, the customary tenure of certain resident forest groups over certain portions of the forest acts as an inbuilt protective shield over flora and fauna resources against other groups that might encroach. The presence of those groups on the ground has often been quite an effective deterrent. Eviction of resident people eliminates the customary protector. Displaced hunters in Gabon, for example, now have increased incentives to intensify hunting by reinfiltrating into areas they knew wherefrom they were evicted. And in my experience, and my organization does do a lot of work throughout the Congo Basin forests, this statement, which was made a few years ago, was quite accurate in predicting what was about to happen. And just this year, it seems at the moment we're moving through a period where the first phase of large-scale, internationally funded conservation projects is about to come to an end. And many of these projects were set up 10 or 15 years or so with aid funding from the United States, from the World Bank, from the British government, and so on. But that funding is now running out, and we're seeing that the protection which we, with our technocratic approaches, have tried to establish is falling apart. And already with this year, two internationally funded schemes in Cameroon have lost their protection. The people that have were evicted from those forests have moved back in with a vengeance, and the biodiversity that was in those forests is rapidly being decimated. In short, I think removing people as an ecological factor in many rainforests may end up at best with what I would call fossil forests, preserved temporarily, but doomed, I think, inevitably to senescence, decay, or outright destruction. And at worst, we may be removing the very people who can protect it in the long term. I think we disregard the role of people in Eden at our own peril. Perhaps most important of all the things that we can learn from forest people is our own very perception of the forest and its canopy. Dr. Jerome Lewis, who is an anthropologist at the London School of Economics and one of the very few people who has a deep understanding of pygmy hunter-gatherers in the Congo rainforests, has described the difference in the pygmy view of the world from that of Western technocratic societies. This, the pygmy view is one of abundance, where the forest, if managed according to age-old traditions, will always provide for them and is thus treated with the respect which one's own body is treated. This contrasts with the loggers and the conservationist view, which are actually two sides of the same coin, which both see the forest not as a place of abundance, but a place of scarcity, in which resources are selectively locked away or priced according to a level of demand in the market, extracted and sold. I was very struck by a recent press release from a major international conservation organization, which has been very much involved in establishing strictly protected areas in the rainforests of Latin America and Africa. And in relating how a new piece of land was to be added to a protected area in Congo, the statement unwittingly, I think, proclaimed Africa's last Eden to become national park. For the people that had formerly lived in that national park, which is now totally depopulated, the arrival of the conservation organization may indeed have brought with it the end of their life in the Garden of Eden. And in doing so, as I hope I've demonstrated here, may well bring an end to Eden itself. Thank you for listening.
First talk in a series on climate change and the interaction with forests. What I'll be speaking about is not only the effects of climate on forests, but also the effects of forests on climate. I'd like to start off with a quote from one of my heroes, Douglas Adams, author of... can everyone hear me? Yeah. I'll start off with a quote from one of my heroes, Douglas Adams, author of the famous work, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And there's actually two reasons for quoting from him here. The first is that, I mean, maybe, I don't know if this is true or not, but I heard that this location before the Eden project was here, the clay pit, was used as a location for an alien planet for the TV series of Hitchhiker. So I was very impressed when I heard that. But the main reason is that as well as being interested in science fiction and writing science fiction, Adams was interested in science fact, particularly evolution and ecology and conservation. And as well as Hitchhiker and other books, he wrote a fantastic book called Last Chance to See, which was, he toured the world with the biologist Mark Carwardine and visited various species which are literally on the brink of extinction. And he made various sort of key observations in that book, and one of them I've quoted here, which seems particularly appropriate, is the system of life on this planet is so astoundingly complex that it was a long time before we realised it was a system at all. And we've heard earlier about interactions between different forms of life at the local level. But what I'm now going to discuss is interactions between life and its environment, taking a whole system view of the entire planet, life and its global environment, and the importance of all the various interactions there in understanding the climate system and climate change. So just to give an overview of my talk, I'll start off by briefly discussing some of the influences of forests on the global patterns of climate, and I'll show how these influences are important for the forests themselves. So that's the effects of forests on present-day climate. And then I'll move on to climate change over the next 100 years or so and discuss some of the work that's been done on assessing the possible responses of forests and vegetation soils to climate change, and then discuss how these responses may feed back on the rate of climate change and actually accelerate it. So the first few slides on the effects of forests on climate. Forests have an important role to play in the water cycle at local and continental scales. The main source of water for the continents is obviously water carried in the atmosphere from over the oceans, and it rains down onto the land, some of which is captured on under the leaves of the vegetation, which can be re-evaporated back to the atmosphere. Other water falls through to the surface. Some runs straight into streams and rivers. Some soaks into the soil, and eventually drains through the soils down into the river systems and back into the oceans. Now, the presence of forests can significantly affect the recycling of water back to the atmosphere. Some water is recycled through evaporation from the leaf surfaces. A lot is also recycled by the extraction of water from soils up the tree roots, and it's transpired through the stomatal cavities to microscopic pores in plant leaves back to the atmosphere. And there's a significant transfer of water back to the atmosphere through those processes. So on the whole, a forested landscape will return more water to the atmosphere than an unforested landscape because of the increased capture of water on the forest leaves and the increased extraction of water from the soils by the deep tree roots. So that has a major effect on the water cycle. Also, this increase of evaporation by forests can have a cooling effect on the land surface. Evaporation cools a body down. If you're wet, you feel cold because evaporation is removing heat from your body. And the same is true of the land surface. If evaporation is increased, say by the presence of a forest, that cools the temperature near the surface. Mm-hmm. So forests can cool their local climate and make their local climate wetter by recycling rainfall. But also forests can make the landscape warmer as well. If you look outside at the banks around the Eden Project, you'll see that the shrub cover and the tree cover appears darker than the grass cover on the hill slopes. The shrubs and trees are absorbing more solar radiation, partly because their leaves are slightly darker, partly because the complex canopy structure is trapping the sun's light and the sun's heat radiation within the forest canopy, and that has a warming effect. So a large area of forest will warm itself compared to an unforested land, and this is particularly accentuated when the underlying surface is bright. For example, in snow cover, the picture here is of an area in Siberia where you can quite clearly see that the snow covered open land is very bright and white and reflecting a lot of the sun's radiation back to space, whereas the forested land is absorbing a lot of the sun's radiation and having a warming effect. So in this instance, where there's not so much evaporation going on, but there's a very large difference in the absorption of solar radiation, forests can have a warming effect. So on the whole, it seems that forests make cold places warmer and hot places cooler. Also, forests and vegetation and soils have a very important role to play in the global carbon cycle, and of course this is a great concern in the current issue of climate change. This is why the complex diagram, so I won't go into all of it, so ignore everything about the oceans on the right hand side. So ignore all of this, I'll just concentrate on these bits here, which are the interactions of carbon between the atmosphere and the vegetation and soils. You'll see that there's as much carbon stored in the world's vegetation almost as in the atmosphere, and even more stored in the world's soils. And there's very large exchanges of carbon between the atmosphere and the terrestrial biosphere, which each flow of carbon is actually larger than the emission of carbon dioxide from fossil fuels which we're producing at the moment. We're releasing about 5.5 gigatons of carbon, that's about 1 billion tons of carbon to the atmosphere per year. There's a release of around 60 gigatons of carbon from the terrestrial biosphere, an uptake of just over 60 through photosynthesis. The respiration is producing the release of carbon. So we've got these large exchanges of carbon between the atmosphere and the biosphere which occur naturally, and they happen to pretty much balance each other out. So we're perturbing this with this relatively small extra flux here, which in itself is larger than the balance between the two natural fluxes. But if climate is changing and vegetation changes, this could modify these exchanges of carbon between the atmosphere and the biosphere and therefore have a further effect on climate. And one way we can actually see the effect of the world's land ecosystems on atmospheric CO2 is to look at the atmospheric CO2 record over the last 50 years or so. This is measurements of carbon dioxide concentration measured at the Mauna Loa Observatory in Hawaii, which is taken as a sort of a general indicator of the global average CO2 concentration. Obviously the main message here is this increase in CO2, which as everyone is aware of now, is causing the climate change that we're now seeing. But on top of that, we're seeing this wiggle every year, CO2 is going up and then down again every year. And the reason for that is interactions with the land biosphere. There's more land in the northern hemisphere, so therefore more vegetation in the northern hemisphere. So in the northern hemisphere summer, as the trees green up and everything starts to grow more, it sucks down some of the CO2 from the atmosphere into the land biosphere, so the CO2 goes down. Then in the winter time, well, the autumn and winter, when everything dies off again, all the trees lose their leaves, some of the CO2 is returned back to the atmosphere, so we get this wiggle every year due to the seasonality of vegetation. So you can quite clearly see that vegetation affects atmospheric CO2. So why do we actually care about the interactions between vegetation and the atmosphere? This is probably quite clear by now what you've seen already. First of all, we're clearly removing large areas of the world's forest. I mean, we've seen several slides now of men with chainsaws cutting down trees, so I won't dwell on this. But that's one way in which we're affecting the climate system. Also, climate change itself. If patterns of temperature or in particular precipitation change, that could make an area of the world less favourable for forests or other types of vegetation. So if the vegetation starts to die, as is in the case in this photograph, that will alter the nature of the land surface and have a further effect on climate, either through water cycles or through temperature or through the carbon cycle. So we're concerned with the vegetation effects on the atmosphere, both as a consequence of the direct influence of humans on vegetation and as a response to climate change and the potential feedback. So first of all, I'd just like to discuss how we can actually do experiments to investigate the effects of forests on climate. Well, clearly we've only got one Earth, so we can't actually do scientific experiments on the Earth itself. We can't go and cut down a whole load of forests here just to see what happens to increase our understanding of the climate system. So what we have to do is use a virtual reality kind of approach, if you like, computer modelling of the climate. In the Met Office, we use huge computer models of the Earth's atmosphere, represented here by this gritty globe here, which we use for forecasting the weather. And we can essentially run those models on for 100 or 200 years and look at the average of the weather over many years, many decades, and that gives us a simulation of the climate. And we can kind of we can tweak with this virtual world. We can kind of play God by changing different aspects of the Earth. For example, we can remove all the world's forests, or we can increase CO2 or whatever, to say what would happen if we deforested the world, or this area of the world, or that area, or what would happen if we increase CO2 by the amount we are expecting. So this allows us to see what the potential effects of our interference with the Earth system might be. And our climate model includes, it's based on mathematical equations which represent the flow of the air around the world, particularly processes such as condensation and moisture in the atmosphere, rainfall, snowfall, the circulation of the oceans, including the Gulf Stream, and also the dynamics of the world's vegetation and soils. We model photosynthesis and respiration and transpiration, and the interactions between groups of vegetation types. We can't represent all plant species in our model; it would just be impossible at the global scale. So we group them into general plant types which share similar characteristics as a first guess at how vegetation might respond to climate change. So the first set of experiments I'll show you with modelling experiments with our computer model concerns the influence of forests on the present day patterns of climate around the world. There's two key questions. What are the effects of forests on present day climates and their own climates? And how important are these effects for the forests themselves? So we'll compare two climate model simulations. One where our virtual Earth should represent the present day state with present day forest cover, and the second simulation where we've hypothetically removed all forests. And the difference between those two simulations shows us what the effect of forests should be on present day patterns of climate. And these the next two slides show some results for the Amazon basin. Here we've got an illustration of the recycling of moisture from rainfall across the Amazon basin. As I described earlier, we get this carrying over of water vapour from over the oceans across to the continent, and it's rained out onto the land surface. In the model, we have about 24 trillion tonnes of water being rained out every year. Some of that drains down the Amazon River back into the ocean, but 14 trillion tonnes, 58%, is returned to the atmosphere to be recycled as precipitation again. And in fact, it's been observed in reality that the Amazon basin does rely very heavily on the recycling of water across the basin from east to west. And this is the simulation with present-day forests present. Then if we go to the second simulation, where we've removed all the world's forests, including the Amazon forest, we get a very different simulation. We find that only 40% of the rainfall is recycled back to the atmosphere, because the tree roots aren't there to extract water from the soil. There's not so much leaf, well, no leaf area there to capture some rainfall and be evaporated. So we get a reduced recycling of rainwater. This is partly compensated for by increased carrying over of moisture from over the oceans, but precipitation, rainfall on the whole, is decreased. So we do get a dry Amazon without the recycling of water due to forests. And we see a similar story across the world. This map shows the differences in rainfall and snowfall added together between the two simulations. So the red and orange colours show where, when there's present day forest included, there is more rainfall than when you exclude present day forests. So here in over the Amazon basin, you can see there is more rainfall, about 1 millimetre per day, which I think is about 10 to 20% of the present day rainfall. That's 1 millimetre per day more with forests than without, and again over other areas of tropical forests, and again over the boreal forests as well. They're also increasing their own rainfall and snowfall. So universally, it seems that the model is suggesting that forests make their climates wetter through recycling of water. Also, the significant effects on temperature, but this is rather more complex. The tropics are cooled because of this increased evaporation from forests, but the high latitude cold region forests
are actually warmed, because as I said earlier, the forests darken their land surface, they absorb more of the sun's radiation, so they have a warming effect. So the presence of the forests in Canada and eastern Siberia has caused these climates to be warmer than they would be without forests. So the question is, how important are these effects for the forests themselves? And again, we can do two further simulations by taking these two hypothetical climates and driving a model of the world's vegetation. The first simulation is driving the vegetation model with the present-day climate, and as you take, we do get the present-day patterns of forests back. We get the equatorial forests there, the broadleaf tree, and the boreal forests in terms of needleleaf tree looking quite healthy as well. Then if we go to the second simulation with the effect of forests on climate removed, we get a very different story. Looking at the broadleaf tree slide at the top there, although we still get broadleaf tree cover in Africa, because the change over Amazonia was much more extreme, we don't actually get the lush forest that we see at the present time. The drying and warming of the Amazon forest due to the removal of the forest has made that climate unfavourable for forest itself. So that implies that if we were to deforest the whole of the Amazon basin, the forest may not actually grow back, or at least it may take a very long time because the climate has become unfavourable. And similarly, if you're looking at the boreal forest, the needleleaf tree slide here, we don't get those forests growing back when we use the deforested climate. That climate is a lot colder without forests, and in fact it becomes too cold and again too dry to support forests. So again, if we removed the northern forests, they may never grow back again. So deforestation both in Amazonia and in the boreal regions may be irreversible or may take a very, very long time to recover from. So the key messages from that are summarised here. Forests generally increase rainfall on land, they make hot places cooler, cold places warmer, and these effects are beneficial to the forests themselves. So this may imply a difficulty of recovery after large-scale deforestation. So on to the second part of the talk, and that's the response of the forests to global warming and the potential feedbacks of these responses to climate change. This shows what everyone's getting concerned about now. This is the global average temperature from the late 19th century up to the present day, April this year in fact. And we can see that the temperature warmed in the first part of the 20th century, flattened off and perhaps cooled slightly in the middle of the 20th century, but then showed a marked increase over the last 30 years or so. And this in particular can now be strongly attributed to the increase in greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, such as carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is one of a group of gases known as greenhouse gases, which absorb the heat radiation given off by the Earth's surface, and they re-emit that radiation back to space, but in the process that warms the atmosphere, and that's global warming. Although water vapour is the most important greenhouse gas in terms of keeping the Earth at its present-day temperature, carbon dioxide is the most important in terms of the changes that we're exerting on the climate at the moment. And this shows the change in the carbon dioxide over the last 1,000 years. It was pretty flat up to around about 1800 or so, and then after we discovered the burning of oil and coal, first of all, we started to increase the level of CO2 in the atmosphere. And it's actually now at a higher level than it's been for the last 440,000 years. And we can use the same computer model for making projections of future climate, and this shows just some projections of global average land temperatures over the next 100 years. Of course, we don't know what our future emissions will actually be. All we can do is make some educated guesses based on various storylines, considering various assumptions about population growth, change in technology, change in agriculture, and so on. And we can come up with a whole range of estimates of different sets of emissions, and this shows the consequences of four emission scenarios, categorised as high, medium high, medium low, and low. It's important to say that this doesn't mean this is the maximum possible or the minimum possible. It just gives you an illustration of a plausible range. And you can see that the computer model suggests that on the whole we expect global warming over land to take place, to cause a warming of around about from 2 to 3 degrees up to around about 8 degrees Celsius over the next 100 years. There's several different computer climate models in different centres around the world, about 20 or so, and they all broadly agree with this kind of range of temperature rises. But there's one key thing which is missing from these simulations and others which have previously been done, and that is that they're ignoring the effects of climate change on forests and soils and the potential feedbacks to climate change, and I'll now discuss the importance of those. What we see at the moment is actually we get a free service from the world's ecosystems and the oceans in terms of removing some of our carbon dioxide which we emit to the atmosphere. This shows changes in atmospheric CO2 and CO2 uptake by different parts of the Earth system over the last 150 years. The black line is the change in CO2. The solid black line is is what we get in our model, and the dotted line is the observed rise, so the model's doing the right kind of thing there. But you see that black line only goes up at half the rate of the red line, which is the emissions. So half of our emissions are being actually removed from the atmosphere. They're not staying in the atmosphere. And that is because some of them have been taken up by the ocean, the blue line, and even more has been taken up by the land ecosystems. This is because photosynthesis is enhanced by increased CO2. So more carbon is drawn down out of the atmosphere as CO2 rises. So we're getting this buffering effect of CO2 rise and climate change by the world's ecosystems. But the question is, will this continue in the future? And the simulations I showed you earlier assume that it does continue in the future. I'll show some slides showing patterns of climate change and then patterns of vegetation change. And you can see what's going on in our model here. These are patterns of warming relative to the present day at around about 2050 and 2080. We see more warming over land, the land simply warms up faster than the oceans. We also see more warming at high latitudes because as the sea ice and snow melts, that darkens the land surface and absorbs more solar radiation, like the effects of forests, that increases the warming at high latitudes. Also, crucially, in this particular simulation, we see additional warming in the tropical East Pacific. This is kind of reminiscent of the patterns of temperature rise you get in an El Niño event, this oscillation in the Pacific Ocean you see on a figurative about 4 to 7 years. You get this extra warming in that region of the Pacific Ocean, which is associated with the drying of the Amazon rainforest and other changes around the world. And what we see is the climate kind of locking into this permanent El Niño state. And this shows the consequent changes in the global precipitation, 2020, 2050, and 2080. On the whole, the global average precipitation increases because we're evaporating more water from the warmer oceans. There's more water in the atmosphere, so increased rainfall and increased snowfall. But the patterns of the wind circulation around the world are also changing, and that can actually cause some areas to receive decreased precipitation. The blue on these figures is an increase in precipitation, and red and orange is a decrease. And crucially, over Amazonia, because of this El Niño-like climate change, we're seeing a slowing down of this sort of circulation of the atmosphere with ascent over Amazonia and descent over the Pacific. We see a slowing down of that, so less ascending motion over the atmosphere, so less convection, less rainfall over the Amazon. So we get quite a significant drop in rainfall over Amazonia by about 2050 and even more by 2080. And this shows the consequences of that for the world's forest cover. This is changing forest cover simulated within the climate model itself, so that as the climate simulation is progressing, the vegetation can grow and die back and feed back on the atmosphere through the water cycle and through changes in surface albedo, surface reflectivity and emissions of carbon dioxide as well. The blue and purple areas show where the forest cover is increasing relative to the present day. So we see the boreal forests are getting greener. In fact, we're already seeing this. I think Sean may describe this kind of thing later in his talk. But we're already seeing a greening up of the boreal forests consistent with a warming of climate and an increase in growth due to CO2 fertilisation enhanced with the photosynthesis. But over Amazonia, where we saw this major drying of the climate, we're seeing a huge loss of forest cover. More than 50% of tree cover in fact almost 100% in some areas, due to the severe drying of the climate. The forest loss itself plays some role in the drying of the climate here. As the forest dies back in the east, it cuts down the recycling of water back to the atmosphere, so you get less rainfall in the west of the basin, so this sort of forest dieback feeds on itself and it accelerates across the basin. It's important to say that not all climate models show this kind of drying in Amazonia. Some do, some don't, and in fact the first talk we saw today showed a map of climate change which showed an increased rainfall in Amazonia. So this is by no means a definite prediction. However, our model has been shown to be the best in terms of its relationship between Pacific temperatures and rainfall. And there's many other areas of the model which we are confident in. So we've not been able to prove this model wrong. So at the moment we can't rule this out as a potential response to climate change. It's also important to point out that perhaps the sensitivity of our model may depend on the approximations we make in the ecological model. I mentioned we generalise our vegetation types rather than representing all types of all plant species. So this decreased biodiversity could make our model more sensitive to climate change. It's been suggested that one of the roles of biodiversity is to make our system more robust to climate change. On the other hand, it's been shown by several groups such as Bill Lawrence and others who work in Amazonia that the man's impact on the forest through road building and logging and so on actually increases the sensitivity of the forest to climate changes, increases the likelihood of fire and so on. So it could be that we're missing out both these processes. Maybe they're counteracting, and maybe in fact in the real world we're making the sensitivity of the forest more like that in the model. And this result has led to this rather macabre cartoon in New Scientist magazine, where they suggest a tour of the Amazon desert in 2030, where the guy is pointing out the last remaining tree. So clearly that has huge implications for the Amazon forest itself, but it also has huge implications for global climate change. And this shows the implications of this for this ecosystem service in taking up carbon from the atmosphere. The red line is the change in the store of carbon in the world's vegetation, which you see is increasing due to increased photosynthesis under higher CO2, and then it starts to decrease around about 2050 because of this climatically induced drying of the Amazon forest. So the world's carbon stores then begin to decrease, their forest carbon stores. But also more critically, we see a loss of carbon from the world's soils. The world's soil carbon stores increase at first because as the vegetation grows more, it pumps more carbon down into the soils. But the rate of decay in the soil depends on temperature. So as temperature rises, that increases the rate of decay. It increases the rate of soil respiration. So that leads to a huge release of carbon back to the atmosphere in soils around the world. So an even more severe loss of carbon from the world's soils. So the obvious implications of that for atmospheric CO2 are an acceleration of the CO2 rise. The blue line is what you'd expect from a business as usual scenario for CO2 emissions, the kind of thing that was input to the simulations I showed earlier, a rise to about 700 parts per million CO2 within the 21st century. If we include these feedbacks from forests and soil carbon releases, we get an accelerated CO2 rise up to about 1,000 parts per million within the 21st century. So clearly that implies a more rapid global warming. This is the change in land temperature over the 21st century. Instead of a rise of 5 degrees Celsius by the end of the century on average over global land, we had a warming of 8 degrees Celsius by the end of the 21st century. So that's a 50% acceleration of the warming over land. And the Amazon dieback is about 20% of the feedback there, so quite a significant part of that. So to conclude then, forests make hot regions cooler, cold regions warmer, and increased rainfall everywhere. And these influences seem to be favourable to the vegetation itself, and therefore recovery from deforestation at a large scale may be difficult. Under global warming, the northern forests expand, but the Amazon forests may die back, and this, in conjunction with the release of carbon from the world's soils, may exert a positive feedback on global warming, and therefore accelerate it, making climate change more severe than we previously expected. Thank you.